Britain's history hasn't just been made by kings and queens and generals and admirals, but by a whole host of ordinary people doing a lot of really terrible jobs. And if you don't believe me, take a look at how we came to rule the waves. This time, luxury liners that needed people working with sacks on their heads.
I am the Bunya man.
How Britain's very first navy survived on minimal rations. And why the heroes who kept our coast safe didn't like getting their toes wet. Welcome to the worst maritime jobs in history. Put the great in Great Britain. International trade, politics, and our military success have all depended on controlling the oceans. Many of our greatest heroes were sailors, legends like Nelson, Drake, or Captain Cook. But despite having trading connections long before the Romans, we hadn't explored the ocean's potential. We had no navy. The sea kept us captive, prey to invaders. But in the 9th century, the threat of the skilled seagoing Vikings forced a national crisis. It was Alfred the Great who got into the record books as the first king to fight back successfully against the Vikings. He built our first navy, which was a fleet of ships based on the drakkar, or dragon ships, of the Vikings. But if you were a land-loving Saxon desperately trying to emulate a Viking, which means sea warrior, you must have had a really miserable time. So my first worst job is the Saxon oarsman. Saxon oarsmen had a double challenge. They had to fight the Vikings, but first they had to overcome their own fear and prejudice about going to sea. They were forced to copy the enemy from the north. So my landlubber's learning curve also begins on a freezing Norwegian fjord with a bunch of experimental archaeologists. Most Viking craft were comparatively small and well built for stability and speed. But as soon as you're on the water, you get a worrying insight into how scary Viking technology must have been for the novice Saxons. How come we've just got onto the boat and it's full of water?
It leaks.
Why?
The planks, basically, yeah, are not tight, and it needs time for the wood to swell. And as you can see, it leaks.
Have a look here, just where my feet are.
It's a constant problem, because if it rains, it fills with water.
Yeah.
If there's waves, it fills with water.
It's a lousy job. Look at this. This is what me as an oarsman would have had to use for the bits that I couldn't reach with the bucket. What do you call that?
It's called a spoon.
It's called a spoon, wouldn't you know?
Yeah.
There's an awful lot of water actually under this decking. I'm not taking that
up.
This is it. Look down here. Look. Yep. Terrific. So I've got to be chucking this stuff out the way all the time.
Yeah.
The water's only just above freezing, the wind chill about minus 10. If your hands are sore from rowing, bailing, an absolutely essential part of the oarsman's job, turns them red raw. And the only alternative to bailing is the backbreaking business of rowing.
There's a lead man who rows, and that's me. And basically, everybody keeps pace with me. Yeah. So it's got to be the guy who basically is at the front, or rather at the back, so everybody can see him.
But a little craft like this could cross the North Sea. They were the long-haul aircraft of their day, forging the Vikings' international reputation at the cost of personal comfort. Even Vikings hated it. In one saga, the hero moans about spending his lonely winter on the ice-cold sea hung round by icicles. If they didn't make landfall, nights were spent in the open boat, with only animal skins and their hairy mates for warmth. Food was pretty basic too.
That's what's called fernalo, and that's salted and dried meat.
Ham?
Yeah. And basically.
Yeah.
And nail that.
Right then. What do you think?
That's all right.
Yeah. And the other alternative is fish.
I'm not quite so sure about this. Mm. Pretty bony. God, it stinks.
Yeah, it does.
But did you bite into the fleshy bit? Or the bit?
Into that bit there. And you just rip it off, bones and all, and just chew it.
That's disgusting.
I can see you're impressed.
But it doesn't taste like smoked fish, does it? It just tastes manky. You've got a mouthful of bones.
Yeah. It's very good for you.
The Saxon oarsmen set the nation on a new course. In the centuries that followed, Britons really took to the sea. Improved design made for much larger ships for trade and warfare. But our history at sea has always meant worse jobs on land as well. And the massive expansion in medieval shipbuilding needed raw ingredients. Britain's maritime tradition starts here, with wood. But in order to work the wood to make the ships, you needed the skills of the shipwright, who was such a highly prized craftsman that he'd certainly never sully his hands by making the basic component of the ship, the plank. Making ships with sawn planks was a new technology. Literally at the cutting edge was one bad job and one worst job.
Damien?
Yeah?
Who was the chap who made the planks for the shipwright?
Well, there was a pair of them. One down the hole there and one up here. The sawyers, you'd always have at least two. They would saw out the planks for the shipwright by the 16th century. And also a lot of the other timbers of the ship. They prepared most of the timber for shipbuilding.
So what was so bad about the job?
Just unending labour. I mean, you know, 6 days a week doing this. I mean, we play at it. We do it for an afternoon at a weekend a few times in the summer. That's OK. But 6 days a week, hour after hour. They had a real reputation for drinking, and you can see why. It's thirsty work, but it's also numbing work. And, you know, you'd rather be doing almost anything else, I think, after a while.
The heyday of the undersawyer came in Tudor times. Thousands of them were employed after the Spanish Armada, building 174 ships in London alone. They got through 40,000 tons of wood. Whole forests were turned into millions of planks and mountains of sawdust. And a word for a whole new underclass was born.
What are these things, these great grips?
These are iron staple things. They're called dogs. The top sawyer, usually the most senior person, standing over the dogs, the top dog, and then the underdog, the more junior person underneath them.
So you're the top dog and Joe's the
That's
underdog.
It, yeah.
Joe, you're the underdog. Do you mind if I take over?
Certainly not. Where you go?
Well, those are small planks you could use for small boat building. You know, for a big ship, they'd be an awful lot bigger than that.
It's a bit manky down here, isn't it?
Well, any hole in the ground tends to get wet. Yeah, a lot of them would be wet and rather stinky.
So, all right, what do I have to do?
Well, the idea is you concentrate on the line, you steer the saw just like a children's scooter, but only on the downstroke.
Yeah.
And on the upstroke, you push up slightly to help me lift the saw.
Okay.
Okay, I'm going to lift it now.
Yeah.
Okay, and then we'll go down. And you've got to tell me if you're going off the line. You have to help me a bit on the upstroke.
Yeah. I tell you,